One of the key Protestant plotters was Sir Thomas Wyatt. In 1554, Wyatt raised an army in Kent and marched on London. But the capital rallied to Queen Mary, and Wyatt ended up in the Tower, branded as a traitor. Wyatt had sent Elizabeth a message warning her of the plot, and she'd replied through an intermediary, making no commitment. But it was enough for her to be suspected of treason. She now sat down to write the letter of her life and to save her skin.
As for the traitor Wyatt, he might peradventure write me a letter, but on my faith, I never received any from him.
Despite her strong denials, she too was sent to the Tower, pending further investigations. It was Elizabeth's darkest hour. Wyatt was offered a pardon if he implicated Elizabeth, but he didn't. Instead, on April 11th, he went to the scaffold, making a speech that gallantly exonerated her. So Elizabeth was saved. She left the Tower the way she'd come, by barge. Then for 4 years she was subject to surveillance by Mary's spies. But in 1558, Mary died. And what had once seemed unimaginable became a reality. Elizabeth, who was Protestant and illegitimate, succeeded to the throne. In exile, she'd been preparing for her takeover and was now quick to assume the reins of power. Within 48 hours of her accession, she had a new council. At its head, Lord William Cecil. Like Elizabeth, Cecil was a Protestant and a pragmatist. Elizabeth asked him to be the judge in the event of any conflict between her personal passions and the good of the country. "Without respect to my private will," she told him, "you will give me that counsel that you think best." So he was the one man with a license to contradict her. And theirs was an extraordinary partnership, which lasted 40 years until Cecil's death. Elizabeth inherited a country in religious turmoil. During Mary's attempts to bring the country back to Catholicism, 300 Protestant leaders had been burnt at the stake. Elizabeth came to the throne with a mission: to cement her father's legacy and make England a Protestant nation. But the country was divided. Most of its people were Catholic. Elizabeth's solution was a classic English compromise, the Act of Uniformity. The Protestants got the Book of Common Prayer, written in English rather than Latin. But alongside this, Elizabeth kept up the Catholic traditions of ceremony. Like her father before her, Elizabeth declared herself the supreme head of the church. The penalty for refusing to acknowledge her supremacy was at best loss of office and at worst death. Dissenters were not to be tolerated. That established, the next problem that loomed was the continuation of the Tudor dynasty. What Elizabeth needed now was a husband. Elizabeth was now queen, but still single. She was Europe's greatest catch, and she knew it. She dressed to dazzle her beholders like a bird of paradise. But there was subtlety in her image too. In this portrait, we see how closely her hand hovers towards the sword of justice, and an ermine scuttles up her sleeve. The ermine was an animal with a reputation for purity. It didn't like to get its white fur soiled. So here, it's a symbol of Elizabeth's own impeccable chastity. But why did she never marry? One advisor, Robert Cecil, William's son, described Elizabeth as more than a man and, in truth, something less than a woman. It's a phrase that's echoed down the centuries. "More than a man," said Cecil. Well, we know that Elizabeth showed as much courage and determination as any man of her age. But what did he mean by that second part of his phrase, "in truth, less than a woman"? Elizabeth's physician once warned her that childbirth might not be easy. He may have been warning her of the dangers then common in pregnancy. Or was he suggesting something more?
There was gossip at the time that Elizabeth suffered from a certain physical abnormality, some kind of impenetrable membrane that rendered her incapable of sexual intercourse or conception. We don't know what it was, but whatever the stories, her gynecological condition was never put to the test. She did, however, fall in love.
Her first love was her childhood companion, Robert Dudley, whom she made master of her horse. But he was distrusted at court. There were whispers that he'd been involved in his own wife's murder. From London to Paris, rumours were rife about their affair.
It fell to Cecil to do the duty once entrusted to him by the young queen, that of standing up to her. With great regret, he told her, if she married Dudley, he would have to resign. It wasn't necessary. Even while they were still playmates at the age of 8, Elizabeth had sworn to Dudley that she would never marry anyone.
She couldn't stop love, though. Later, she fell for the Duke of Anjou. Cecil and her advisers had proposed the Duke, a French Catholic, as an ideal diplomatic flirtation, whether or not it led to marriage. But Anjou came over to woo her in person, and she was simply smitten by him. Elizabeth behaved recklessly. She may have felt that it was her last chance to marry. She seemed to be pledging herself in public to a Catholic and a foreigner.
Had she lost her mind? This was supposed to be foreign policy, not some flaunting of love to infuriate the people. But at the court, opinion was divided. Old Cecil, who was bedridden with gout, favoured the marriage, exclaiming, "Blessed be the Lord." But her ladies-in-waiting wailed and laid terrors before her. By the morning, Elizabeth realised she'd gone too far. What had started as a diplomatic game had become seriously amorous. She raged, she wept, and finally she sent her suitor back to France.